Good morning, dear students. In our previous class, we had focused upon the goals of psychological research and also on the steps to conduct scientific inquiry. In today's class, I will start with the nature of psychological data. As you can see on the slide, there are various nature of psychological data have been highlighted. Well, the different types of data that psychologists normally collect our demographic information, which includes personal information like name, age, gender, birth order, education and occupation. Physical information, this includes ecological conditions, mode of economy, housing conditions, size of rooms, etc. Physiological data. In some of the studies, physical, physiological and psychological data are collected about height, weight, heart rate, level of fatigue, and galvanic skin responses. Electrical activity of the brain is measured by electroencephalogram, blood oxygen levels, reaction time, blood pressure, etc. Psychological information may relate to areas like intelligence, personality, interest, values, creativity, emotions, and motivation. Now, having understood the nature of psychological data, we need to focus on the important methods of psychology, which are enumerated as experimental method, observational method, correlational method, the survey method, and case studies. Now we will take up observational method today. The observational method. Now what is meant by observing? Observing or observation is a very powerful tool of psychological inquiry, which helps in describing behavior. A scientific observation differs from day-to-day observation in many respects, which include selection of the data, that psychologists do not observe all the behavior but deselect a particular behavior. For example, if you want to study the activities of nursery children, so in that case you can observe them in the school setting. Recording of the data. The researcher records the selected behavior by using different means, like frequency tallies for the already identified behavior, taking notes, using shorthand or symbols. Then we come to analysis of data after making the observation. It is the role of the psychologist to analyze whatever they have recorded with a view to derive some meaning out of it. Now after this, we are going to concentrate on types of observation. As you can see from the slide, it is of two types: naturalistic versus controlled, and non-participant versus participant observation. Naturalistic observation, as the name suggests, takes place in real life settings or in a natural setting. For example, you can observe children in the school, that is naturalistic observation, where observer makes no effort to control or manipulate the situation for making the observation, like you can do in home, schools, daycare centers. And controlled observation is where you need to control certain factors that determine the behavior, because they are not the focus of your study. Now, there is an experiment given on page number 29 in box 2.1, which talks about the contribution of psychologists Bibb Lachanet and John Darley, who conducted a study in 1970 on the university students. They were asked to come for an interview, and every student was sent to a waiting room with a preliminary questionnaire. Some of them found two other people already seated in the room, whereas others sat alone. And after some time, when they started working on the questionnaire, the smoke began to fill the room. The smoke could hardly be ignored. Within 4 minutes, the room contained enough smoke to interfere with their vision. Now, they wanted to basically study that how frequently the students left the room to report this smoke or emergency. It was found that 75% of the students who were waiting alone were reporting the smoke, but those who were waiting in groups were in less. So controlled observation is where you need to control certain factors. Smoke could be introduced in a controlled laboratory condition only. Non-participant as well as participant observation. As the name indicates, the non-participant as well as observation is that particular observation where the observer is, he just may become the part of the group which is being observed.
In the first case, the person being observed may not be aware that he or she is being observed. Like you want to observe any pattern of interaction between the nursery children and their teachers. So that is a non-participant observation. Okay? So you may decide to sit in the corner of the class and you do not interfere in their day-to-day activities. This is non-participant observation. In the case of the participant observation, however, one may decide to observe the person from a distance, and the observer becomes a part of the school or the group of the people being observed. Now, having focused our attention on the differences between these two types of observations, we need to know the merits and demerits of the observational method. The advantage is that it enables the researchers to study the people in a naturalistic situation. It is a very simple method, and a little training can make a person perfect to observe the surroundings. The demerits are the observation method is very labor-intensive, time-consuming, and it is influenced by the observer's bias, that is, his own judgment may color the observation. Our observation is influenced by our values and beliefs about a particular event or because of our past experiences. So, in a nutshell, we recapitulate today's session as that we have different types of data, such as demographic data, environmental data, physical and psychological data. But the psychological studies remain located in a context and are tied to the theory and method. Different methods are used for collecting information. We have today done observational method. Observation can be done in a naturalistic or controlled laboratory condition. It can even take place in the form of a participant or non-participant observation. So please study these concepts, and then we will continue the next method in the next lecture. Till then, goodbye and thank you.